It's time.
RPG gamer here. I'm mechanically inept at just about everything else in this medium, so I rely on turn-based books with occasional options to prop myself up as an expert. Chrono Trigger, Lufia 2, Secret of Mana, those games are like the holy grail of my youth. Final Fantasy X is a good game. Shitposting aside, I wanted to write up a college thesis on the genre, since it's almost always brought into scrutiny by the misinformed, and is either criticized for not having any sort of depth of mechanical input, or has its core mechanics stripped down so it can be shoved into the orifice of any game that refuses to incorporate any actual mechanics or depth itself. So rather than spend the time acknowledging criticisms towards the genre as a whole, I figured I'd use the time to castrate and highlight two examples, two separate entities in the genre to discuss while tackling and highlighting core issues a lot of these games end up facing, and ways to counteract these issues. The two games in question being Final Fantasy VII Remake and Yakuza Like a Dragon. Both games here follow the same structural core of your average Japanese role-playing game, but while one is a homogenized result that aims to appease the masses, the other is both a celebration and major advancement on the formula as a whole. Let's start with the former here. Final Fantasy VII Remake. FF7R is the latest episodic entry in the compilation of Final Fantasy VII meta series, and while it's the latest entry, you don't necessarily have to indulge in anything prior to actually understand and enjoy the game itself. Some would argue that not knowing anything prior would actually enhance the experience, as its ending would leave you with hope and excitement for the next century, and not dread and uneasiness, knowing that the long-awaited remake of one of the most famous JRPGs to date released with less than 10% of its original content. But I'm not really here to harp on with my own opinion of how the story was handled, well, not entirely, but generally the gameplay and the structure as a whole. The thing that'll strike notice first for most is the gameplay, as it's more or less a real-time action game, rather than a turn-based role-playing game. There are methods to play it similar to a turn-based JRPG, but you miss a slew of nuances by doing so, and here's where I find the game's biggest strength and taboo as a whole. FF7R is probably one of the easiest JRPGs to get into, given how streamlined its combat is this time around. But like anything, streamlining removes mechanical fidelity and risks the genre slowly shifting its way towards a similar style. It is a good change of course, but one that leaves restrictive development time and design space, as well as creates a sort of identity crisis for FF7R, not knowing if it wants to be a traditional RPG or a straight-up action game. Comparing the remake to an older or even newer RPG, such as Dragon Quest VII or Octopath Traveler, just from first glance you should notice the amount of customization both for character, parties, and player expression is at an all-time low. A player's Maribel or Tressa could function completely different from another player's Maribel or Tressa, but as a whole, most players are going to have vastly similar Tifas or Clouds during their playthroughs. And that isn't to say that the remake lacks player expression or variety as a whole, but compared to the norm that most Final Fantasy fans have gotten used to by now, they're going to be thrown off with how railroaded things feel from start to finish. If they haven't already felt that way with Final Fantasy XV, but that game is a topic of its own. Inversely, given that this is an action RPG, the same nuances that exist in action games like Devil May Cry and Bayonetta have been exempt from more traditional RPG mechanics. Movement and freedom that Dante and Cereza express and obtain during the course of their own games simply isn't present in the remake. And while you do obtain upgraded material and skills throughout the course of the game, it just doesn't feel like enough there to have Cloud be as expressive as he would want to be. He's stuck in a game that refuses to accept either identity as its own. He's doing the same thing he did in the beginning, just with higher numbers, where his action protagonists can obtain weapons, skills, spells, and abilities that can completely alter how they function. Of course, you could argue that it's unfair to compare turn-based JRPGs to an action RPG hybrid like the remake, but that's exactly my point. Homogenization exists when you make these kinds of radical changes, and FF7R is a victim of this. Of course, this is just one side of the dice. As I mentioned earlier, the party variety is lacking as well. You can make the argument that party choices will expand as more episodes release, but I'm here judging the full $60 game we were presented with a year ago, not a potential what if that we have 6 years from now. And that isn't to outright say the remake is an incomplete game, but again, it's further proof that player expression is being stripped from these titles. And while, yes, even in something like Final Fantasy III, where you only had 4 party members, you could drastically customize those party members to perform any role you want. You can't really do the same with Aerith or Barret in the remake, as they're both going to play almost exactly the same regardless of what they're wearing. With, of course, an exception of, like, Aerith smacking enemies in the face or Barret punching enemies, but those kinds of things are so lacking in nuance, most players aren't even going to bother with that sort of thing. Whereas compared to a game with different roles and styles, most players will mess with characters playing as thieves or white mages or anything of the works like that. It's hard to state that you won't prod at its episodic development, while that has been such a hand in how the game as a whole was designed. And it brings me to the next point, that the Final Fantasy VII Remake is an extremely linear game, and once again, this is an issue that's anything but in other titles. 20 hours into the remake, you're still watching the narrative, running through the same linear dungeons located in Midgar, and fighting enemies. 20 hours into the original Final Fantasy VII, you have Fort Condor, all the shit you can do at Golden Saucer, Chocobo Breeding, and a huge overworld to explore and get lost in. Final Fantasy X was also linear by design, but you have a fully developed game in Blitzball to delve into whenever your brain started to rot from the same turn-based combat screens you were involved in. And yes, quality among these things is subjective, but nearly every JRPG would have something to break up the same structure so you weren't completely overloaded with the same exact gameplay loop. And it's something a ton of older RPGs started to pick up as the genre started evolving. Having the remake be akin to Final Fantasy I in terms of how it was designed at its core is a complete regression to the genre and the opposite of what we should be aiming for. And just to add here, I'm aware that 7R has some segments that aren't exclusively the regular combat loop, but they just lack overall depth. The squatting and pull-up challenges only last for 3 difficulty settings and will only take about 10 or 15 minutes of your time before you've completely maxed them out. The dart minigame will take even less time than that. And the dancing and bike segments only happen once or twice respectively during the story, requiring the player to restart the chapter itself to experience them again. It's just the sort of development you'd find in more narrative-heavy action games that use minor minigames as a small point to breathe, rather than an optional excuse to break from the potential monotony you'd potentially feel in regards to this genre. And it's fine if you'd rather your narrative set pieces take center stage, but strong narratives are a part of just about every RPG worth their salt, and they never sacrifice side content. Well, besides trash like Pokemon, but that's another topic for another day. Breaking up monotony is what keeps this genre alive as a whole, on top of all the other systems that popularize this genre in the first place. Persona 5 would probably be ignored, if not for the multitude of activities you could partake in, and was only reduced to dungeons and mementos. And I think this is a critical flaw of the remake itself. Rather than fun content you can indulge yourself in to increase the potential of runtime, you're left with the same combat by the end of it that you started with initially. And this may seem minor, but it's a staggering issue that can make or break these kinds of games. It's why nobody's bothering to discuss the old Final Fantasy games in a truly positive and endearing light, why some Final Fantasies are remembered fondly at all, and why some are held to the gold standard they've always perpetuated, which what Final Fantasy VII set itself for initially. With that out of the way, I'd like to move on to what I believe should be the golden standard moving forward, Yakuza 7, or Yakuza Like a Dragon. At its core, Yakuza 7 is a modernized Dragon Quest game with a Yakuza coding. And while the remake may come off as a poor Final Fantasy game, Like a Dragon stands proud as an excellent Yakuza game, despite how drastically different the gameplay is. But I'm sure by now you realize that I'm less so tackling the narrative brought about by these games, and more so the general gameplay philosophy these two titles built themselves upon. Yakuza 7 perpetuates itself like the JRPGs of old, with a large world, or in this case town, or in this literal case district, to explore. Tons of non-player characters to interact with, and tons of activities to indulge yourself in, following the story of Ichiban and his ragtag crew, building themselves up from nothing. Also, the protagonist can get one more word in with his surrogate father. And with Low Clash Japan being showcased in full alongside a Dragon Quest backdrop and gameplay loop, it really perpetuates the experience into something special. All the while not feeling the need to streamline anything specifically to engage at a wider audience, and thankfully being one of the most successful Yakuza games to date because of it. Of course, there's a ton of bits here to a point where I would have been better off comparing the remake to an older Dragon Quest game, but this of course only enhances that the turn-based gameplay of old is definitely not outdated. For starters, just from the 4 party members you'll most likely be using throughout the entire game, there is a slew of variety among each of them, be it through different weapons and different classes. As someone's Titus or Waka will function differently from another's, so will someone's Nanba and Adachi. Each character being allotted to several classes and roles to fulfill, fulfilling a massive amount of player expression even better than most other games in the genre. And again, that's something that will always be important for role-playing games. The player isn't aiming solely to play as Cloud or Ichiban, but to play out their own iterations of Cloud and Ichiban. And while, yes, narratively, that will be impossible for games similar in vein, players are able to tout different functionalities and gameplay perks tied to their characters still goes a long way. It's a major reason why games such as The Elder Scrolls and Fallout end up being so popular when mentioned alongside the genre. Another aspect I do think is crucial for this game's success are the side activities. Although you're free to, you aren't just watching lengthy cutscenes and engaging in the same turn-based combat for 40 hours. Ijinicho is filled to the brim with extra shit to do when you simply want to break from the narrative. Simplistic activities like poker, darts, mahjong, karaoke, and batting cages exist for fun novelties, and while their depth is comparable to that of what's contained in the remake, the quantity of shit you can do here really helps, and in the instance of player distractions, quantity is almost always going to be more important than quality, as there will always be something minor for players to invest in. But the great thing about Yakuza, and not just 7, but in general, is that it almost always hits quantity and quality within its games. Survival Can Collection is simplistic, but has enough mechanical depth raising in the difficulties to keep the player enticed long enough to max out their standing within it upon gaining access to it for the first time, and the same can be said for several other games. Property Management has its own economy and own set of in-game rules of its own, from where you can allocate your money and investments into whichever cash generators you decide to purchase early on, to which employees you want to invest in for both how well they function managing your properties, and how well they perform in combat scenarios against shareholders with those subsequent meetings. Dragon Kart is its own kart minigame that could even rival most indie kart racing clones, with tons of nuances when engaging the racetrack, several different karts that function, excel, and lack in their own areas, and even a narrative that serves as an additional hook to the player. And while I'd say it has less overall depth than something like Pocket Circuit Fighter, it still lands on its feet, being a very diverse and developed side activity in this game's setting. Hell, not only did they put 10 gigs worth of effort into the slot machines, but they put the same effort coding in a launch PlayStation 3 title in Virtua Fighter 5. None of this shit was necessary, but they did it anyway for no additional charge. And while I haven't named all of them, and while there are several others with their own varying degrees of depth and intricacies, there's a lot of love put into these simple extra activities. And not only does it exist to aid in keeping the gameplay loop not exhaust itself, but it also helps make the world feel as alive as any continent Yggdrasil perpetuated in its own respective series of games. And I think the best part about these sorts of things is that they're almost always optional. This isn't to knock the narrative set pieces like the bike chases present in 7R, but if a player doesn't want to indulge in any of these extras and just focus on the story, they're free to do that too. And including more options for the player over the course of a game is not only more beneficial in just about any game setting, but also one of the greatest strengths of this genre. You aren't forced to worry so much about a combat system when you have all these individual pillars holding up the entire experience. And generally, that's Yakuza 7, with class and character building that rivals games like Zodiac Age and Bravely Default, and has enough mini-games to even make a WarioWare title blush. I'm not looking necessarily to review the entirety of Yakuza 7, but what it does for the genre is monumental. A role-playing game designed to be a role-playing game, where my biggest complaint are the skippable cutscenes that can drag out longer than necessary. And I think it's completely fair to compare something with so much depth to the Final Fantasy VII remake. I want to address that it's clear a ton of passion and work was put into both of these games, but the major point here is that a lot of work may have been put in the wrong areas. I don't think FF7R is a bad game, far from it. I just think it's a bad role-playing game, and exists to do harm to the genre if too many developers look at what Square did and follow suit. On the other hand, I hope that RPG devs take a good hard look at what Like a Dragon did. There are so few RPGs out nowadays that have taken so many cues from our older ancestors, lathered them with a new coat of paint, and made them function as brilliantly as they did. And I honestly believe Yakuza 7 is both the definitive JRPG experience and the definitive Yakuza experience. I love role-playing games, I love the genre, grew up with it and all, but with the constant stream of linearity and recession brought among the games, to where even the old gods like Final Fantasy VII are being tarnished for the sake of delivering a more action-oriented experience. It always worries me that we'll lose out on what we could have with future releases. But Yakuza 7 gave me hope. A lot of hope. A lot more hope than just nearly every RPG I've played since New Vegas. And I really hope that developers really do take note from it, as it should be the gold standard for this genre, not some DMC Lite with meager stat management. Thanks for watching our video. Please purchase Persona 4 Golden on Steam, so I don't have to use a jerry-rigged PS3 emulator to play my favorite fighting game. Thank you.